We couldn't believe what we really saw.
What if someone or something could warn you about the future?
Half man, half monster, or I guess you'd call it.
Never seen anything like it. I hope I never do again. You know, it was just unbelievable.
But the very sight of this messenger filled you with terror.
Those eyes. That's all she'd ever say was those eyes.
What if it showed you a disaster was about to occur, but no one would believe you?
People were screaming. You could hear them hollering for help.
It's already happened, not just here, but all over the world. And it's happening right now. Wherever this messenger appears, tragedy follows. What went on in Point Pleasant? What did they witness? Where will it go next?
What if? And if's a big question.
It's a story most of us have never heard. Now they're making a movie about it called The Mothman Prophecies. But this is no Hollywood fantasy. The events and the people are real. You're about to hear eyewitness accounts from the past and profound lessons for the future. This is a search for meaning hidden on the edges of accepted reality. This is the search for the Mothman. Throughout history, stories have circulated of enormous flying creatures, dark-winged beings that prophesize death and destruction, but generate such fear that eyewitnesses can't face or understand their meaning. Author Lauren Coleman has been researching these creatures for over 30 years.
Mothman really fits right in with the long history that we have of seeing winged creatures, flying humanoids, big birds. They've had many different monstrous names down through history, and they really start from the times of the ancient Babylonians up until, you know, a month ago.
Writer John Keel was in Point Pleasant, West Virginia, when the events there took place. His book, The Mothman Prophecies, is the definitive account of those sightings.
These things have always been here. The Indians in America here called it the Thunderbird, a huge bird. In the Orient, they called it the Garuda.
You can go all the way back to 1880, when a strange flying man was seen over Coney Island, New York. The Houston Batman of the 1950s. Rio Grande, 1976 is one case. Right now, you've got a wave of Thunderbird sightings in Pennsylvania. And so Mothman, if you look at it in context, is not that unusual, but what makes Mothman so interesting and really exciting is that you have over 100 witnesses saying they saw it in one concentrated area in 13-month periods.
It started with an incredible story that John Keel ran across in a small-town newspaper.
I was driving around the South where they had a lot of UFO sightings, and I was, Mothman thing broke. It came over the wires. Four young couples had seen something in Point Pleasant, West Virginia.
It was November 15th, 1966. Late in the evening, two young couples drove to a remote hangout on the outskirts of town.
Two couples riding around, joyriding around the TNT area, which is a munitions dump from World War II. But all of a sudden, they see these giant red eyes. Very apparent that they aren't supposed to be there. And all of a sudden, they see a form to it. The form takes shape. They see there's huge wings to this form.
We couldn't believe what we really saw. And this thing was standing there, but it had a body just like a man. You could see muscles in its legs. We sit there for a minute and looked at each other, and then we took off.
And they get scared, and they want to get out of there. And all of a sudden, they're taking off. They're going anywhere from 100, 120 miles an hour. And they notice that this creature is following them. And they can see it through the back window. The shadow, you know, is going across the car once in a while. And they can't get away from it.
We didn't really talk about it or anything. But we saw it all the way down the road into town. It followed us.
They couldn't get away from it until they, you know, almost got to the edge of Point Pleasant.
The creature vanished as they entered town. And the couples headed straight for the sheriff's office. He went out that night to investigate their story, but found no sign of the creature. When Linda finally got home, family friend Doris DeWeese was there to meet her.
When they got home, she got in the house, she collapsed. Of course, they had to call a doctor and have him come out, give her something. I mean, she was hysterical. That's all there was to it.
The following day, the sheriff held a press conference at the county courthouse to discuss the sightings. The local press jumped on the story and dubbed the mysterious flying creature the Mothman, after a character from the Batman television show. Doris remembers vividly how Linda described it.
The head looked like a man, and it had fiery red eyes, half man, half monster, or I guess you'd call it.
Something unnatural was stalking the hills of West Virginia, and John Keel decided to go and see it for himself. But this was only the beginning. Others would encounter it, and tragedy would soon follow in its wake.
All I could see were these two red eyes. I kept looking at it. I couldn't stop. And then I guess it just took off.
When writer John Keel arrived in Point Pleasant, West Virginia, he could tell something had the community on edge.
Yeah, you could feel that something was happening there. And so I lingered there, and I started getting into all of this stuff. I found many strange things going on in the homes, and I found that many people had seen things but never reported it to anybody.
Past few months, people have been coming up to me and reporting that they've been seeing strange things. And I'm not talking about the town speed freak. I'm talking about good, honest, church-going people. Now, I've known these folks my entire life, and they seem downright embarrassed to be bringing it up.
Bringing what up?
It's hard to explain.
The capital of Mason County, Point Pleasant is a tight-knit community of 5,000, where everyone knows their neighbors, where life moves at the simple and welcoming pace found in the rural South.
Everybody thinks of hillbillies when they think of West Virginia. They were not hillbillies, and they were not the kind of people that would make these things up.
Since the 18th century, farmers have made a good living from this fertile land along the banks of the Ohio and Kanawha rivers. Researcher Dan Drazen visited Point Pleasant in 1966 to investigate the strange sightings.
People seem like ordinary people, very friendly, matter-of-fact folks. What you see is what you get. I felt very welcome in the town.
Just north of town is a densely overgrown wildlife preserve, much of it almost inaccessible. But hidden beneath the thick brush is evidence of a grim history. Part of the area had been used during World War II as a place to covertly manufacture and store munitions. Remnants of a factory still stand, along with almost 100 large concrete domes that were built into the ground to house the high explosives. Because of its past, locals dubbed it the TNT area. That's where Marcella Bennett was headed on the night of November 16, 1966. She and her brother were bringing her three-year-old daughter to visit relatives who lived on the outskirts of the TNT area. As they pulled up near the house, they spotted some strange lights in the sky that hovered above the trees. Marcella's brother was mesmerized.
I told him I didn't want to see any lights, and he says, no, stop. He said, you got to look at this. This isn't a plane. And I said, oh, sure, you know. And I just kept on walking towards the car.
She was carrying her daughter when suddenly a figure stirred nearby.
I had just approached the car, and out of the corner of my eyes, I saw this creature, which was over 6 foot tall with feathers. It just looked like a giant bird, but yet a man. And it was standing with his shoulders and then its neck down in like this. I just couldn't imagine what I was seeing and panicked. And when I tried to run, I couldn't run.
In a state of shock, Marcella fell to the ground directly on top of her little girl.
I couldn't get up to get off of her. And I thought, well, you know, she's dead. You know, I'm killing her, but I couldn't move. You know, it was just, I was in a trance.
Finally pulling herself together, she picked up her child and ran towards the house.
When I finally did get up to my feet and get my feet working, I realized that my knees were all torn up and my hands and my face had been buried in the sand. I couldn't see. And I thought I heard the creature fly off with these real loud flopping wings, you know, made a real loud sound.
The family locked themselves inside the house, but hysteria gripped them as the creature reappeared, shuffling onto the porch and peering into the windows. The police were summoned, but it had vanished by the time they arrived.
It was just very frightening. The worst frightening experience I've ever had, you know, in my life. And hope it's the last. It still bothers me to even talk about the creature, you know?
Marcella relived the incident for months and was so distraught that she sought medical attention to deal with her anxieties. To this day, she is tormented by frightening dreams and visions.
I could be driving along and all of a sudden I'd feel like there was something in the back seat and I would just hit my brake, you know? I'd just slam on the brake and just turn real fast and look in my back seat. The presence of him was still around, you know? And that was an eerie feeling.
For those folks in West Virginia, it's a trauma. It's a trauma as big as anything they'd ever experienced, and they're gonna be frightened for their whole life.
John Keel's stay in Point Pleasant turned from days to weeks as more and more eyewitnesses came forward.
Most of them were just bewildered. There were a few who were very afraid to go out of their house at night. It did cast a shadow over the whole valley.
Well, what did you see?
Now I was looking at it in the sky, and then all of a sudden it just, you know, just sort of sank right into the trees, you know, and it kind of moved around a little, and it looked like, you know, it's trying to get away.
And then it's kind of froze. It was terrifying. That's the last we've seen of him. That was enough.
There's very little humor in these stories. These are people who were genuinely terrified or genuinely puzzled.
John Keel became convinced that something very serious and very real was going on. But no one knew what it was, why it was there, or what it meant. More sightings would be reported, and not just of the creature. The situation was about to become even more terrifying.
Mr. Klein.
Hey.
I gotta talk to you. Last night, I woke up with the worst headache I've ever had in my life, and I went into the bathroom to get some aspirin, and I happened to look in the mirror, and I swear to God, I see something I can't describe, but it sure as hell is not my reflection.
Through the winter of 1966, sightings of the creature known as the Mothman continued to be reported around Point Pleasant, West Virginia. Not only were eyewitnesses terrified and emotionally disturbed by their encounters, but some were even physically affected, exhibiting strange burns on their skin and inflamed, swollen eyes.
I woke up and nearly both my eyes were swelled up.
What did the doctor say?
He couldn't explain it.
See this one here? It ain't never healed.
Her eyes, the first thing I seen was swollen and red, and water was coming out of them.
Keith Aker was 17-year-old Connie Carpenter's boyfriend at the time, and soon to be husband. Connie herself is still, even today, too frightened to come forward and tell her story, so Keith agreed to set the record straight.
I'd like people just to understand that I'm here to make sure that they don't think that she's a kook, because she's not. And what she has said she's seen, she has actually seen.
Still in high school, Connie was driving home when she saw something unusual on the side of the road.
I don't know what caught her attention, whether it was a shadow or what, but she said she looked and slowed down, and here it was. Wings come out and it went straight up. And she said it hit it right for me. She said all I could see was the red eyes. I went to the house that night, and her mom met me at the door and said she's in bed. She didn't want to come out of her bedroom. Those eyes. That's all she'd ever say was those eyes.
As writer John Keel puzzled over the exact nature and meaning of the creature sightings, he began to connect them with the dozens of local UFO reports he'd heard.
There was a man here from New York trying to find out as much as he could about the flying saucers.
Doris DeWeese was one of the people John tracked down and interviewed.
We lived on Madison Avenue over in Point Pleasant. And every night there'd be flying saucers going over. I was scared to death. Because, I mean, you know, we had no idea what they were going to do or what their intentions was. We figured they were from outer space or something.
That's where I first saw it at. Seen the lights rotating. It looked like it was about 4 feet high, maybe 6 or 8 foot wide. And the lights were multicolored, red and white, yellow, green. And it was just circulating like it wasn't making any noise. And it disappeared as quick as it appeared in the first place.
Long, cigar-shaped type vehicle that looked so close that you could look up, you could just jump up and touch it. It had lights all on the side. It was completely silent, didn't make any noise whatsoever. We were just in awe. We just stood transfixed. We just couldn't believe that we were seeing what we were seeing.
UFO reports poured in. And the local media picked up on the frenzy.
This is desolate Dry Ridge Mountain, where last night a strange and eerie thing happened.
That it was this big orange glowing light, you know. So we stopped the car and the thing came over top of the car. We got all kinds of static on the radio and the car quit.
John Keel himself witnessed these strange lights in the sky.
I began to see them myself. It was beyond imagination. They were extremely bright lights, which could hover. If you flashed a flashlight at them, they'd respond, they'd flash back. I saw a lot of these lights. In fact, I saw so many of them, I lost count.
John Keel was at a loss to explain what was happening to the town, whether it was all connected, and why it was happening here, of all places.
To this day, we can't really tell you what those lights are.
Now, improvised search parties are combing Dry Ridge Mountain, attempting to find it. Just what it is, no one is sure.
The community was on edge, afraid of the night and what it might bring.
They had the National Guard out looking for it. The state police was patrolling the area where it was seen. People would go out at night with lights and stuff. It was almost like a search for Frankenstein. Well, I wasn't with them. I was too scared to go at night.
But I know one thing, I lock my doors at night. I mean, you know, before we never locked doors. We always left them unlocked, but after that we started locking doors.
But other mysterious forces were at work in the town. Someone didn't want these stories to be told and threatened those who spoke. Who were these men in black? And why did they want to cover up the truth? Around Point Pleasant, West Virginia, reports of creature sightings, UFOs, and strange phenomena continued for months.
I went back several times, you know. I wasn't there just once. I'd get back to New York, be exhausted, and the phone would ring, and somebody that I had met down there would be calling me and telling me about something new that had happened. I realized after a while that this was folklore in the making.
Alexander Leak.
Who the hell are you?
I'm John Klein. I called you last week.
You know what that is? I'm sorry, but I'm already late.
Look, I need to know what this is. Tell me.
Where are they seeing it?
Point Pleasant, West Virginia.
Adding to the town's hysteria was the presence of mysterious visitors. Strange men dressed in black who didn't want the truth to be told.
And he said, we don't want to hear any more about this, and he left. So after he had said what he did, we didn't say any more about it.
A local newspaper columnist named Mary Heyer was helping John Keel with his investigations. She died soon after these events, before she could discover what was really going on.
Mary was the kind that would investigate anything that had a story to it. And this here was a story that she had to find the truth out about. And I believe she would hunt it and hunt it and hunt it for years until she found it. She's like Mr. Keel. He hunts for the truth, and she was too.
Mary was quite frightened. She was frightened for her life. She said these men had visited her quite a bit, and she said these men in black had olive complexion, and she noted one thing that I always thought was very strange. She said they didn't blink their eyes, and they would ask her questions about the Mothman.
Well, I've been around a lot of reporters in my life, and there are some I wouldn't play cards with, let alone accept their stories. Mary was very trustworthy.
She truly felt like they were a threat to her. And she felt like maybe it was because of the reporting that she was doing. And she wasn't sure whether they intended to make her stop or, but she was into this now and she wasn't going to give it up.
It's just something that's, it's eerie. I don't know why they was coming around at that time, but they'd been in different homes, different places, asking questions.
But Keith Aker never expected anything to happen to him or his wife, Connie.
I'd come home, and she was scared. She wouldn't come out of the apartment. She wouldn't even answer the door, and I'm glad I had a key, because that's the only way I got in.
Keith found Connie cowering in the bedroom, and he slowly coaxed her into talking to him.
She went down that morning to get in the car, and some guy pulled up and asked her for directions. So she goes over, and he grabs her and tries to jerk her in the car. And she said he was dressed in black. I said, now, this is too weird, but I know what took place. Because the blouse that she had was ripped, and she would not rip her clothes herself.
Not long after, a threatening note was left on Connie's front porch.
She more or less crawled into a shell. She didn't want to be by herself. She didn't want to go anywhere by herself.
Why wouldn't someone want you to talk about the Mothman? That's a good question. I really don't know. This whole business about men in black and silencing witnesses, you know, you have theorists who say it's the CIA.
But to this day, the government has denied any involvement in Point Pleasant.
Well, I called the Air Force in Columbus, Ohio, and they just sort of poo-pooed it, turned it off. And it's always been a puzzle.
Local residents began to ask why this would happen to Point Pleasant. And while some still dismissed the strange phenomena as the product of wild imaginations, sightings continued to be reported. Everett Wedge was one of the community's most upstanding and respected citizens. He was one of five pilots who were standing on a local airstrip when they saw what they described as an enormous dark-colored bird flying above them.
And it was big enough that it could, I'd say it could pick me or you up and probably carry us away. That's how big it was. I've been around lots of my time, and I never ever saw a bird that big, but I did see it. And like I say, I might not have quite 20/20 eyes now, but I did then.
At 7:15 a.m. on November 25th, a shoe salesman named Tom Urey was driving just north of the TNT area.
I noticed something out of the corner of my eye from the riverbank over here. And it came up over the trees, and when I first saw it, it looked like a helicopter coming up. And then when it came up over the trees, I could see it was a bird, a huge bird. Estimating the wingspan, I would say 10 to 12 feet, give or take on either end, up to 15. I'd never seen anything that large before in my life. I was scared, but I wasn't terrified. It was just a strange feeling. I mean, I'd never seen anything like it. I hope I never do again, you know. It's just unbelievable.
And a few months later, the local Red Cross Bloodmobile was chased by the creature.
And this thing hovered over the Bloodmobile. They sensed it, and then they looked out the windows and looked up, and whatever it was a huge thing. And they thought that some like claw-like things were descending and going to grab the Bloodmobile. And he drove out of there. Then there were a number of other cases that tied it in with blood. What cinched it for me was in talking to female witnesses, I would ask them about their menstrual period. And a lot of these women who claimed to have been chased in automobiles were having their menstrual period at the time. And that seemed to me to be a major clue of some sort.
Reports of missing dogs and mutilated cattle only serve to heighten fears.
Usually the animal has been drained of blood, but there's another clue to these animal mutilations is that very often the anus of the cow is removed, and we know that radioactivity settles in the anus, and whoever's doing it is checking the radioactivity influencing these animals.
Obviously, something was happening here, something unexplainable and terrible. But no one at the time had the foresight to understand exactly how horrific it would eventually turn out to be. Dozens of innocent people would die before the truth was known.
How many people have seen it?
10, 20 maybe.
Listen to me, something terrible is gonna happen in Point Pleasant. Don't go back. Stay away.
The strange phenomena continued in Point Pleasant for over a year. By December 1967, over 100 sightings of the creature had been reported. And people weren't just seeing it. They were dreaming about it. Eyewitnesses complained of nightmares and dark premonitions.
If you look at some of these winged wonders, these creatures, like Mothman, like the Cornwall Owlman, like the Thunderbirds, there's this interwoven kind of tradition that they're banshees, that they really are the prophets of doom in many ways.
They're in the old legends, if a bird looks in your window, you're in trouble, big trouble.
You read in some of the traditions of the Cherokee, where there's actually warriors and braves guarding the women when there was a Thunderbird time. In Cornwall, and some of the Owlman reports, and somebody was gonna get in an auto crash or, a kid was gonna die.
I was getting anonymous phone calls and could never figure that out. I was getting phone calls warning me about this and that.
Hello, John Clark.
Who is this?
My name is Indrid Cole.
But yours is way down here in the normal vocal range, anywhere between 1,000 or 1,200 cycles per second.
Okay, so this guy's vocal range is much higher than ours.
What makes you think it's a man? What is it? Near as I can tell, it's an electrical impulse.
Mary Heyer, the reporter friend of John Keel, had these dreams, incredible dreams in which she saw Christmas packages in the water, but she had this feeling there was going to be a major disaster and it was going to happen any time.
But no one expected the tragedy that followed. Almost 13 months to the day of the first sighting of the creature, disaster struck.
I was planning to go back down to West Virginia in December of that year, and I had repeated phone calls warning me, don't go to West Virginia, because they knew that I would be using the bridge, whoever they were.
Main Street in Point Pleasant led straight onto a suspension bridge called the Silver Bridge. Spanning the Ohio River, locals would cross it on a daily basis, sometimes several times a day. At 5:05 p.m. on December 15th, 1967, the bridge was full of cars, many of them Christmas shoppers, when suddenly it began to shake. Charlene Wood was on the bridge at that very moment.
When I got to the traffic light here in Point Pleasant, I got the red light. When it changed, I started going up onto the bridge. And just about that time, the bridge started shaking.
What is the first thing that happened, Mrs. Fowler, that made you know something was wrong?
The bridge was swaying. And we heard a loud noise.
And at that point, I thought someone had hit the bridge underneath one of the boats or barges. And I threw my car into reverse, and as I threw it on reverse, the bridge incline came up this way, and as I backed off, when my car stopped on me, My tires was right on the ledge where it broke off. And as I got down, I could see the bridge was falling. And people were hollering and all.
How far were you from absolute safety?
I'd say over a car length. If I'd have been another car length, I'd have made it.
It came down like you'd stack dominoes and give them a push, and you know how they'll fold. That's the way it looked like it was folding toward me.
We run back that way to see if there's anything we could do, and we could see this one big tractor and trailer must have been way back, and you could see it floating. And other things are floating down the river, and these people started to holler in there, and we was trying to help them. Wasn't much you could do.
People were screaming. You could hear them hollering for help.
The Silver Bridge collapsed catastrophically, completely disappearing beneath the river's waters. 46 people died, making it the worst bridge accident in American history at the time. For days, rescue workers pulled smashed cars and bodies from the river.
The question of what caused this bridge to collapse is right now still of absolutely no import to us whatever. It did fall. There are bodies still out there in the river. We are right now interested in getting those bodies recovered from the river.
The bridge was gone. There was debris all over the water, and it was so cold. It was the coldest day we had that year. That was the 15th of December of 67.
In the following weeks, the Department of Transportation conducted a detailed investigation of the collapse and blamed it on a steel pin that was improperly manufactured. The Silver Bridge was nearly 40 years old, poorly maintained, and had for many years been carrying far more traffic than it had been designed for. Quite simply, they concluded, it was a miracle that the bridge stood for as long as it did.
People said it was overloaded, but it wasn't. It was just normal traffic, and there was a snow shower, you know, flurries. It was kind of the sun had gone down and all, but never dreaming something like this would happen.
It's eerie what took place to cause that bridge to fall. I don't know why. All I can say is a lot of people lost a lot of loved ones.
Rumors quickly began to spread that the collapse was connected to all the strange sightings.
You look at the Silver Bridge crashing, and people talk about the Mothman as being this banshee before the bridge collapses, telling people that they should be aware something's going to happen. Mothman 13 months, you know, from the 15th to the 15th, over those 13 months. And as we know from the analysis of the bridge collapsing, it was pin number 13 that collapsed the bridge.
Some people theorized that the bridge collapse had been caused by whatever was causing these strange events, and that this has been done as a distraction. Some people said that when everyone's attention was focused on the bridge and the rescue efforts, that a great deal of UFO activity was seen departing the TNT area and had not been seen since.
There are also individuals that said they saw the Mothman under the bridge during the collapse.
And there was a wino that went down underneath the Silver Bridge, and he said he seen the Mothman. Well, he came up there and reported to George Johnson, the sheriff at that time, and it came out in the paper that so-and-so had seen this Mothman on the bridge. Well, in less than a week, the bridge fell. So it's the things like that.
What was sighted on the bridge were two men in low oxfords and black jackets climbing around the bridge. Now, that I suspect they must have been FBI agents, and I suspect that they knew what I knew, that something was going to happen, but they knew it was the bridge. I didn't know it was the bridge.
Others told of being visited before the collapse by the creature, and finding themselves unexpectedly waylaid when they tried to get on the bridge that afternoon.
I keep wondering, why me? Why was I saved and all? But I believe there was just another purpose for me at this time.
Now that it's all over and you look back, what's your thought?
Lucky. That's all I gotta say. It's lucky.
As the town mourned its dead, the frenzy over the creature abated. Attention turned to grieving and recovery, not prophecy.
was to the point that nobody wanted to talk about it. They wanted to forget it and get on with our lives and pretend it didn't happen.
One of the most peculiar things about that event was that after it occurred, all of this anomalous activity seemed to disappear, seemed to stop.
But it didn't stop. The Silver Bridge collapse was only one of a series of tragedies. The creature would appear again, and disaster would strike wherever it was seen.
You know, the buildup of energy before something happens, the way your hair stands up before lightning strikes.
Before something happens, do you mean, that they cause disasters?
Why would they need to?
All right, then, are they trying to warn me?
Their motivations aren't human.
After the collapse of the Silver Bridge, the Mothman vanished from Point Pleasant. No more sightings were reported. No UFOs. No strange men dressed in black. Their sudden disappearance lent credence to the notion that it had all been somehow connected to the bridge disaster.
And it was almost continuous that these things were being seen. And then it just stopped.
You know, we tried to figure out what, why, and all this, but there was nothing explained that we could explain.
First the flying saucers, then the Mothman, and here the bridge fell. I mean, it was scary.
There were 100 sightings in Chernobyl the year the nuclear bomb went down. Galveston, 1969. Just before the hurricane, they saw it.
Some tried to come up with scientific explanations for the Mothman. Skeptics claimed that it was a mass hallucination that had been cleared up by the shock of the bridge tragedy. Others blamed it on a curse placed on the town by a Shawnee chieftain over 200 years before. And a local ornithologist claimed that it had really been just a big bird all along, a sandhill crane. This species superficially matches descriptions of the creature, but eyewitnesses disagree.
Wrong color, too skinny. Now, I've seen pictures of sandhill cranes on TV, and no. In my opinion, Professor Smith from West Virginia University was 100% wrong.
Various college professors tried to say that it was a stork or something dumb like that, and some people said it was a giant owl. Well, I've seen large owls, but I've never seen an owl that as big as a man.
It was also later revealed that the TNT area, where many of the sightings took place, had been horribly polluted. Many of the ingredients that had gone into making the munitions had been dumped and left to seep into the local ponds. In the 1970s, scientists declared the area an environmental disaster. It is still one of the top EPA Superfund cleanup sites. So some wondered if perhaps the creature was some sort of mutant bird, an abomination caused by the horrible effects of toxic waste. But that didn't explain the strange lights in the sky, the abject terror felt by eyewitnesses weeks and even years after their encounter, even today.
You know what you saw, you saw it, but what was it? Where did it come from? These are questions you ask yourself all the time. Is there something out there that, stalking us? I mean, you can't deny what you saw. It's just very hard to explain, Very hard to explain.
I mean, that's something strange. They're here 1 minute, gone the next. Why did they come here in the first place?
Too many people saw it, whatever it was, for it not to be something.
And it has been seen again. Sightings have been reported around the world since then, always just before a major disaster. Mexico City, 1985. Reports of huge, strange birds appear in the weeks before a destructive earthquake rocks the city. Chernobyl, 1986. Locals describe frightening encounters with a bird-like man over the course of several months, encounters that end with a devastating accident at the nuclear power plant.
Going on all over the world. It still is. And I've gotten tons and tons of mail from it, from people claiming similar experiences or thanking me because suddenly they realized what they had really experienced. what they'd really gone through. A lot of people all over the world have seen these things and been bewildered by them.
Dozens of sightings have been reported in just the last few years. And in September of 2001, an eyewitness came forward claiming to have seen an enormous bird-like creature in western Pennsylvania.
It was just like one of those 8mm black and white horror films.
Perhaps once we are able to overcome our fear and look beyond the mere manifestations, humanity will finally glimpse the real truth. For now, however, there is no rational explanation for what has happened and seems to still be happening.
I'm sure it's happening somewhere in the world right now. It has always happened.
I really understand that people are skeptical of Mothman. I would be, you know, if I hadn't been doing this for 40-some years. But for these folks, they interacted with an extraordinary situation that they couldn't explain. And we know from looking at those folks, talking to them, looking at their histories, looking at the whole framework that Mothman fits in, that something very real happened there. We don't know what it is, perhaps, but we know it was real.
The only thing I'd have to say is keep an open mind, because someday it could happen to you. And then if you try to tell somebody, what are you going to do if they laugh at you? Or if they call you a kook, that you're imagining, or you're trying to cause chaos, but it actually did happen. What if? And if's a big question.
Point Pleasant and around the world. It's been seen before, and it will be seen again. What will you do if you see it? Will your friends and family believe you? Will you believe yourself?
The unknown is out there, and the universe does not exist as we think it exists. And we don't exist as we think we exist.
These entities are more advanced than us. Why don't they just come right out and tell us what's on their minds?
You're more advanced than a cockroach. Have you ever tried explaining yourself to one of them?